So let's start because we are running late again.
Okay, so we are going to have three papers in this session. Unluckily, just one of the three. The first paper, the authors will be here presenting face to face. The other two papers, the authors are from Cardiff University and they will be presenting online. Okay, so the first, I think the first authors you know pretty good. So it is a research titled Integrating Formal Methodologies in a Multilayer Analysis for Managing Policies for Pedestrian Use of Public Space. And Katharina Rugo and Flanky Morais are here. The other two authors, Joaquin and Jorge, are not. And I think Franco wants to play a video and be hidden while it's playing.
Yes, you can.
So I just play it and.
Yes, it's better because time control and my English is not so good.
Okay, so I think it would be better then that we turn off the lights, right?
As you know, the imposition of measures to contain the COVID-19 pandemic resulted in a great growth in the use of public space at the expense of private space, much more closed. This was the immediate reason for a study carried out by the municipality of Porto on the occupation of public space, responding to the need to preserve the public interest in relation to the pressure felt in the licensing of private requests. The study focused on the pedestrian space, but it did not limit itself to studying space occupation. It also intended to respond to broader concerns, both environmental, public health and people's well-being, including economic concerns, increasing sociability and vitality in the cities. All these problems are positively addressed by urban walkability policies. We are not going to describe all these aspects here, but we will focus on presenting just one of them, pedestrian occupation and in particular pedestrian traffic. It should also be noted that the project objectives were not only cognitive, but essentially active, to provide the city council with proposals for public policies, namely municipal regulations, and also, and this is very important, to provide the municipal service and technicians with instruments for analysis and decision, for which we privilege the formal and digital methodologies and tools. In our scheme of architectural activity, this study participates in two cycles. The first is the long term of research, trying to create or improve the theories that will be used to fulfill the second and short term cycle of the application of those theories to each of the practical cases of social demands or responding to social demands. The research used count surveys, computer vision, and machine learning techniques to improve the later user methodologies of multimodal mobility space syntax and agent-based analysis. The data addressed by those theories was the configuration of space, both geometric and functional, and the behavior of agents in the space, in our case, the pedestrians. The theories are then formal, general, and abstract relationships between users and space, that is to say, function and form. Let's begin with the data. Possible ways of collecting information on the uses of space are summarized in this table. Traditional manual counts, public surveys, automatic counts by a lot of techniques, social networks, video images, GPS, Wi-Fi, GSM, and many other. For our purposes, we need to gather information low cost, well disseminated, with a minimum impact on the protection of personal data, and mainly powerful. Based on those criteria, we decide for manual counts, street surveys, automatic counts, and video cameras. The most relevant for us was just this one, the images obtained by video cameras disseminated in the city. They are publicly owned and managed by the municipality. The main reason for this option is that it was possible to obtain very detailed information about movements of people and objects, which allowed for a much deeper knowledge than mere counts. Nevertheless, multiple problems arise from the application of the legislation of the protection of personal data, which is very, very restrictive. For example, it's not possible to record any image except by low court order. It's necessary to understand that video image processing applications do not have human mental process, which make identifications of colors, textures, shapes, objects or people in an almost transparent way for human beings. All this identification has to be carried out explicitly in computer algorithms. This process uses frames of pixels and analysis of comparison, patterns, contrast, textures, and so on, without any individualizable semantic value. There are several different strategies for these applications. The first, through intensive use of deep learning, identifies objects in each frame. That is, it's able to discriminate the various objects that appear in the image and identify each one of them. We can identify the type of object, the faces, VIPs, or even identify a certain person, or a number plate. Everything here is forbidden. Fortunately, there is another strategy which obtains much less information, but is much easier to implement, does not pose problems regarding the protection of personal data, is compatible with available computers, and even so obtains very relevant information. The technique is to analyze change between successive frames, very similar to the compression techniques that everyone knows and are using animated images. Change between the frames do not allow you to individualize objects, but allow you to reach very significant information. Briefly, we arrive to paths of moving objects, time, position, dimensions, and the generic shape of the object, which allow fruitful analysis in terms of the use of the public space, but not any personal identification. The problems arising from the strategy are diverse, including the IA methods are reduced to unsupervised techniques. There is no re-verification of the information obtained by comparison with the recorded video image. Object tracking is not perfect for multiple reasons. For example, in the case of compact groups, there is a great difficulty in individualization. The global solution for acquiring knowledge that was adopted consists of carrying out four distinct phases. The first phase in real time is the one already described. Different filters and parameters were used to improve the quality of the information collected, for example, tuning of brightness, color, generic dimensions and shapes of different of significant objects, object immobilization times, and prediction of trajectories for past crossings between diverse pedestrians. The second phase is dedicated to the geolocation of objects, projecting the location on the screen's frame to a three-dimensional geolocation in physical space. The third phase consists of essentially heuristic process to improve the identification of objects and paths, for example, concatenation of paths with several reference. Two identical paths from two cameras are the same path. Separation of compact groups and so on. The fourth uses generally AI supervised machine learning processes. Although this is a major research contribute, I'm passing through this because you will see the results of it on the slides ahead. I'll pass through this also. Well, although the most significant methodology to obtain data, video cameras was not the only one. We also used manual counts, but here with some improvements. We have immediate geolocation, precise moments of the passing, the type of entity, pedestrians or motorized bicycles, direction of the movement. We need also some subjective evaluation of the public space, and we use two types of field surveys. Yet another counting system was used, the city's public transport service, as an automatic registration of the validation of transport tickets. So it's a system without added costs and with a huge profusion of data. The analysis of pedestrian traffic revealed that there is extreme sensitivity to all the small volumetric accidents of space. For this purpose, an exhaustive survey was carried out of all the existing equipment, dimensions and location. The various coverings of the entire ground floor of the space were also considered. The functional aspects of the space are also extremely relevant, and both the use of the space itself and the use of the entire surroundings must be considered. The formats of the information storage intended to make them available to the computer applications that would be used and those that are available in the municipal service. Multiplicity of formats and their compatibility had to be ensured. Now we depart from data and we arrive to theory. There are three large groups of methodologies for the treatment of pedestrian traffic. First, very closely linked to the most theoretical engineering, which will seek its inspiration from the dynamics of fluids and is essentially expressed in differential equations. The second, also from engineering, but of a much more empirical character and with simple formulations to treat more current problems. And the third group comes from architecture and is based on the configurational analysis of space using concepts of analytical and mass geometries and graph theory. For our purposes, we needed to use theories easy to use by the technicians of the municipality, able to deal with medium scale and big scale urban spaces, and of course powerful. Based on these criteria, we decide for a multimodal mobility analysis and SCAVA theories. The project is the multimodal mobility analysis methodology to study the easiest and the most immediate solutions, space syntax methods for a more detailed study of complex spaces, and especially the more versatile agent-based analysis, which is basically the same as that of cellular automata. It's some kind of miraculous point of contact between two completely different backgrounds. The main used methodology was agent-based analysis. Agent-based methodologies allow studying the relationship between a space and the objects, the agents, that move within it. The space can be extensively detailed, and the agents obey sets of programmable and parameterizable rules. Well, the application launches agents into the space. Launching agents will obey two types of application usage. In the first learning phase, it's then according to the empirical data collected either in the accounts or in the information collected from the video cameras. The launch timing can actually be empirically gathered. In the next phase, there are already defined statistical parameters for the place and time of the successive launches of the agents. Well, this is maybe one of the most interesting results of the project type of rules in the agent-based analysis, the rules for the displacement of the agents. For example, if they have a destination or not, what is the target of the destination? If it is not the displacement is not directed to a destination, what kind of interests the agent have, the type of places he want to visit, the amount of work the agent is capable of doing to avoid collisions, to avoid crowds, to stay clear of walls and obstacles, or if he's guided by previous knowledge of the space, or if they are not and they are guided by what they can visualize, if he turns right or left, if he prefers to keep direction, if he uses criteria of shortest path, least time, more or less turns, more visibility, and even the use of prohibited places. The pedestrian uses the lane for mechanical traffic. The following features show results for several different situations using agent-based analysis. In this one, agents prefer the shortest path. In the actual case of the space with channels for pedestrians and for mechanical traffic, and on the other side, the consequence of the pedestrianization of the entire space. Here, the agent rules favor much more visual aspects such as occlusiveness, which brings them closer to the centers of space. In this one, the introduction of a compact terrace cafe and the same but more dispersed, they are studied those two situations. Other methods were also used. The easiest theoretical methods used in the project were those currently used in traffic engineering, multimodal mobility analysis. Here is an example of the levels of pedestrian service for a certain street along the day. Space syntax methodology is another used methodology. For example, segment analysis were carried out to be able to integrate the analysis of small areas of public space, square, street, garden, within the overall configuration of the city without ignoring the relationship that are established between these little areas and the entire city. The figure shows the integration, a space syntax quantity of the entire city and also an area bordering the metropolitan area. This table shows the space syntax configuration or properties of the public space zones and stuff. For the purpose of zoning the city, the functional aspects of the use of space were also introduced. This feature shows the map of the city's points of interest, and this one shows the density maps of points of use for services in the left and the tourism in the right. Another methodology associated with the space syntax is the VGA visibility graph analysis, perfectly adjusted to the scale of the cases in the study. As they are also current methodologies, we will not detail these studies. VGA makes it possible to carry out studies similar to those performed by agent-based methodologies. This is proven by several decades of scientific studies. For example, in this figure, we see the integration map, another space syntax quantity of the same zone shown in the previous figures presented for agent-based. The project also used the space syntax methodology in three-dimensional models. These models do not bring any substantial advantage to the analysis of traffic, but they seem to bring something new to the analysis of other aspects of the use of public space by citizens. Among these aspects, for example, visibility in 3D spaces is much more intensively analyzed. For example, to determine the best locations of specific observation points of monuments, the skyline protection, the protection of privileged views, sky visibility, consequences on visibility of the forestation or deforestation of public spaces. The figure shows the visual integration in a 3D model of one of the public spaces of the city. An aspect to be highlighted refers to the integration of methodologies to obtain meaningful information from one to the other. This table is a chart showing a combined use of methodologies. There is another great conclusion, and the final conclusion, the need to make the use of new methodologies much more widespread in the professional practice of architecture and urban planning, and to be available at the most diverse levels. The project placed that in the hands of the technicians of the city administration, a set of work tools that included not only the computer applications that we already mentioned, but also training actions in these applications, their theoretical foundations and in their practical potential. Also, the entire large set of relevant information was made available for future uses in various formats to allow its use by a very vast set of digital tools, more or less disseminated. The figures show precisely the same map of results from a space syntax analysis in the original format and in Google Maps from GIS.